didn't look like the one who would be king. He was a shepherd boy, and yet he became one of the greatest kings in the history of Israel. God chose the tiny nation of Israel to represent all of mankind. All of the disciples were uneducated, undisciplined, fishermen and tax collectors, and yet God used them to change the world. In our Joshua 2 passage this morning, we again have God using ordinary people to do extraordinary things. After reading through the passage, I was like, oh, I can't preach on all this. And when I began to pray, the Lord said, well, you really don't have to go far beyond the first verse really to set this whole thing up so that we can understand what the message of God is trying to give us. There's someone here today who God has been calling. Someone here today who is just an ordinary person who's gone through ordinary things, but that does not mean God operates. Our God operates, and he can use, repeat after me, say, God can use anybody. I'm going to make that the title of the sermon. It wasn't the title of the sermon, but it is now. God can use anybody. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you would open up.
Joshua knew that
Judah, that was going to be the first city that they were going to have to conquer once they crossed over the promised land. And so he sent two spies in to take a look and see what was going on. So my first question was, Joshua, why did you send the spies? God is on your side. Do you really need the spies? But what I found out is that sending spies where you were going to attack was an old tradition. And if you will remember, 40 years earlier, Joshua was a spy. Remember, it was in Numbers, the 13th chapter. God told Moses to send 12 spies in. This is interesting because he told him to send 12 spies in, and then he named the spies. So there was a spy from each one of the tribes of Israel, and if you read that chapter, the 13th chapter, it gives the name of all of the spies. It's very open, it's very public. I guess today we would say it was transparent, that he let everyone know what was going on. Now, of course, that mission didn't end too well for the children. Of the 12 spies that went out, 10 of them came back and said, there's no way we can go because there's giants in the land. And it was only Joshua and Caleb that came back and said, if God is on our side, it doesn't make no difference how big the giants are. And so I want to tell you this morning, if God is on our side, it does not make any difference how big the giants are. In the name of Jesus. Because it didn't go well last time. Even though Joshua and Caleb were the only two who would remember this, because all the rest of them had died in the wilderness, but those stories were passed down from generation to generation. They told how the spies went out, and the spies brought bad news, and they had to wander for 40 years. So Joshua said, we're going to send two spies, and we're going to tell nobody about it. So I had to wonder, I wonder how long it took Joshua to recruit these spies. I wonder if these spies were trained to be spies or he just made an open call. I need two people to go into the promised land. It's a dangerous assignment. I don't know if you're going to make it, but I need two to go. You see, because sometimes it's difficult, even if we ask somebody just to be a part of a committee in church. Yeah, and they're going to enemy territory. A couple of people to volunteer, a couple of people to step up, but we don't want to do anything. So I'm wondering if, there's 2 million people. I wonder how many people told Joshua, I'm too busy. I wonder how many people said, no, I'm working, Joshua, so I can't take the time to do what the Lord has called us to do. I wonder how many people told Joshua, no, Joshua, I've got a plane in the sand and something else I have to do. I wonder how difficult the recruiting of these two. Oh, help me, Lord. So the Lord said, it might have been he only got two because that's only two in volunteer. Help me, Jesus. Somebody, you know who clapped? The chairperson of our church council just clapped. Help me, Jesus, because we're always. We're asking people to do stuff and can you read scripture? No, when did you learn? Did you know how to read? I can't read that. I can't do this. When we struggle in the church to do anything, we're not asking you to go to enemy territory. Hallelujah. We're just asking if you're willing to go. Yeah. We're just asking if you're willing to step up. Oh, I don't know if I can do that. Repeat after me. God can use. Anybody. Help me, Jesus. So your excuse doesn't don't even work with me. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. The excuses. God has been calling many of us to go. You may be sitting there silent saying, but I know I can't go. I don't want to go.
Israel had gone through, because remember Joshua, here Joshua was a new leader. Joshua was a military man. He was not one who was trained to take millions of people across into the promised land. He did not think he was very easy anyway. He didn't think he was a man. But God can use
anybody.
Joshua said, no, it can't be me. I'm just a follower. I'm just a man behind Moses. But don't you know, God is training us all to do something for the kingdom of God.
Yes.
Repeat after me. God is training me.
God is training me.
To do something,
for the kingdom of God.
Because God can use
anybody.
Everybody gonna get a call this week.
Maybe it was that they remembered what they had told Joshua. In Proverbs, in Joshua 1 and 16, it says that they answered Joshua, whatever you command us to do, we will do, and wherever you send us, we will go.
Oh my God. Oh my God. Well, y'all mark that in your Bible. Joshua 1 and 16. Tell me, Lord. So when you get that call, I ain't going to ask you what to do. You have to read Joshua 1:16. Because God can use
anybody.
Help us, Lord.
God called on our lives. You see, but we have to understand. And sometimes we get tripped up. We don't understand that God has been training us all our lives.
Yes.
God has been getting us ready all our lives. All the stuff that you went through, every school that you went through, every Sunday school class, maybe something for God. Hallelujah. How many of y'all went to Sunday school with something for God? Is that all you had? She was getting y'all ready. Getting y'all ready. Everybody like, not me, yes, you. God has always been preparing us to do something great for the kingdom of God. Everybody can do it. Everybody. The Bible tells us that everybody has at least one gift.
That's right.
At least one. And that gift is meant for the building up of the body of Christ. The gift is not meant so that you can get a promotion. Help us, Lord. Now, the gift will help you get a promotion. But it's not for that. The Bible says it's for the building up of the kingdom of God. So God has been getting you ready to serve in the church. God has been getting you ready to get excited about what you can do in the church. God has been getting you ready to be just enthusiastic because God is prepared and ready to use your gifts and the talent for the kingdom of God.
We got four people.
Bless you.
I would like to say hello to those folks who are on the internet as well. Amen. Thank y'all for tuning in. God bless you.
And so we need to understand that God has always been getting us ready. All of these gifts have been getting us ready to serve. So somehow Joshua, he who thought he was not prepared to lead the people, and the two spies who finally volunteered said, we will go. We're not spies. We don't know what we're doing. But if the Lord told us to go, we're going to go.
And the Bible tells us in verse 1 that the two men went into Jericho, and they went into the house of a prostitute named Rahab. Now this has been so very interesting throughout the years and years of people who have been studying this and reading this, all the theologians and all the commentators and all the preachers talking about why did the Lord use a prostitute? Why did these men go into her house? You see, it's obvious that these men stuck out. It might have been, the people of Jericho, that all people look different, they dress differently, they speak differently. And so as spies who were going in, there were a lot of people who went in and out of Jericho, but you have to understand that Jericho knew that there were 2 million people from the kingdom of Israel who were just across the river getting ready to come across. And so there was a lookout, there was a call out for spies who might be coming in the land because they knew. And the Bible said that they went to her house. So here's what we understand about prostitutes of that day. Prostitutes of that day, most of them were innkeepers and barkeepers. So most of them had an inn where people who were visitors to the city would come in and they would stay. Most of them a place where people could come in and they could have drink. And most of them could stay so they could come in and do whatever. But anyway, y'all with me this morning?
places in the city because they found it easily and they went to that place because her house, her place would be one of the places that spies could go because they had to get off the street. They couldn't walk around because people would be looking for them. And so here it is that we have Rahab, who is this innkeeper. Rahab, the only place that they could go. And we must understand, and this is why we need to understand this, that there is a divine providence when you do what God has called you to do. Things may not make sense, but if God calls you to do it, God is going to make a way. If God calls you to do it, God is going to open a door. If God calls you to do it, there's going to be something that's going to happen that's going to blow your mind. But God is going to make a way out of nowhere. So here are these spies lost in a city they've never been in, and now they are in Rahab's house. And the other thing about being in Rahab's house is that, you know, when it reminds me, any of y'all watch Gunsmoke?
Yep.
Y'all know Miss Kitty?
Yes.
They don't say Miss Kitty either, but. She's Miss Kitty, yeah. But Miss Kitty was running the house. Come on now, let's be serious. You know, and so this always reminds me of Miss Kitty. And the thing about people who run bars and people who have those kind of establishments, they know everything that's going on. They know, they hear all the news, they hear all the talk. Because you know when men get in there and start drinking, men get in there and start talking. And so going to a place of someone like Rahab, of the house of a harlot, you would go into a woman who knew all kinds of things that were going on, and we have to understand that it was a divine influence that made the men to go to there. God moves us into strange places. But here's what I want you to, we need to understand that in our lives, God may place peculiar people in peculiar places that we are supposed to be. Repeat after me, God will place peculiar people and in peculiar places that we're supposed to be.
God wants to know, what are you willing to do for the
But God saw her, and you see, God knew her heart. Oh, come on, watch this. All the stuff that we've all been through, all the stuff that we've all done, God knew our heart from the very beginning in the name of Jesus. And God's awesome grace, we talked about grace, and there's this grace, we talked about it in Bible study. I'm not going to call nobody out, but we talked about it. We talked about prevenient grace. And prevenient grace is the grace that God has for everybody, whether you're saved or not. In other words, God has grace for you because God knows I'm just getting you ready. I want you to know, there's some times, oh Lord, I know I got more than at least one testimony. There's somebody here, you went through some stuff and you almost got caught, you almost got killed, you almost got cut, and you almost got shot. But because of grace, the heart of grace on your side, because God stepped in and said, no, I got a prayer for you. What am I saying? There's somebody you need to touch. There's someone where you need to go. Because I gotta get, I don't care. You've been in the gutter for a long time. You dirt, you dirty, you ugly, you stinky. Help me, Jesus. But that does not mean, hallelujah, the blood can cleanse you. The blood can change you. The blood can change your lifestyle. The blood can make you brand new. The blood that flows through Jesus Christ and for us can make you a new creature. And he can make you no matter what you've done, because we're going to say it one more time, God can use anybody in the name of Jesus. But I don't think you and nobody up in here that has an excuse. Absolutely nobody. It doesn't make any difference what you did, where you go. God's grace, his prevenient grace was already with you. Watch this. Come on, Holy Spirit. Repeat after me. If God didn't want to use me,
I'd be
dead. Oh, I'm going to let that one sink in for a minute. Hallelujah. God had a purpose for your life. If he didn't have a purpose, he wouldn't need you to be around. Hallelujah. But you are here on purpose. You are here so God can use you. You are here so God can change you. You are here so that somebody can see who you were and now who you are in the name of Jesus, so that they might understand God can use anybody. We gotta share this with our children and our children's children. You see, you know, when the children go away, the children go away to college, I don't want to talk about me. Boy, you big and bad, you can do anything you want to. That's why the freshman year is all that right. First semester of the freshman year, ain't nobody trying to bring your report card on. I got an A in one subject. Hard. Party 101, boy. I was good on that one, boy. I did a good job, party 101. All the rest of the classes, I didn't have to go in class. What nobody thinking? The teacher wasn't even taking attendance. Praise the Lord. This was like, I'm free. I can go anywhere. I can do anything I want to. Come in turn, like, oh, I don't know none of this. I don't know. No, I ain't took a note. Most of the time, and I hate this 8 o'clock class. A Monday 8 o'clock class was just worthless. It was just worthless. You know, if I couldn't show up, I was sleeping in the class. Lord Jesus. Oh, I'm the only one. Okay. I'm the only one
who missed the party. Help me, Lord.
Some of y'all still go to the festival club. I know you know the name, you probably ain't getting no more, but y'all don't name the club. Y'all look at me like I'm crazy. Oh, no. Look, I'm going to say something. I'm not going to say something. Y'all been staying all your life. Help me, Jesus. Y'all didn't even watch Soul Train, did you? Help me, Lord. No matter how bad I was, no matter
in the play yesterday when they had Jesus walking on the water. Great scene. And Peter jumps out of the boat. And Jesus is standing in the water, and Peter walking, and the wind is blowing, the waves are going, and Peter starts looking around, and Jesus said, No, don't look at all that, look at me. You see, if we can keep our eyes fixed on Jesus in the midst of our storm, oh, come on, Holy Spirit. If we can keep our eyes fixed on Jesus when things are going bad, if we can keep our eyes fixed on Jesus when we think we're about to drown, if we can keep our eyes fixed on Jesus in the worst situations, that's where your help comes from. In the name, your help ain't coming when you realize that the storm is about to take you out, but the storm is greater than your God. In the name of Jesus, we need to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. You see, we tend to look back and see who we used to be, where we used to go, how we used to act, all that stuff. But that does not make any difference. If you give your life to Christ, behold, I declare this morning, you are a new creature in Christ, and God is waiting to use you, and God has you. Trust and believe that no matter what you're going through, somebody's watching. You got to go through so somebody can know, somebody can have a testimony. That was in our New Testament scripture. It says that you will be my witness. So all that you've gone through, all you've gone through, repeat after me, said, I've gone through.
I've gone through.
But I made it.
Thank you.
we are a child of God, a benedict child. God serves a benedict God. And we know today, God can use anybody. We're going to tell somebody this.